I was Hanny Yasha Boy Rico from Street Scores, and that was a great win. You can argue that was one of the most impressive wins since Ron Rivera has been our head coach. Definitely easily in the top three. Same thing with Taylor Heinicke. That's arguably his best game he's ever played for us. That's honestly one of Scott Turner's best play calling games as well. And do we finally have a franchise kicker? Like, do we finally have that guy? That, like, we're no longer on the kicker market. Some people were talking about we may even have to spend a draft pick on kicker. I mean, granted, like a late round pick one, but I mean, it was getting really bad, and we may have found an answer in Joey Sly. So this is really interesting. So y'all already know how my game reviews go, man. We're gonna go position group by position group. We're gonna talk about coaches as well. We're gonna talk about positives and negatives. Of course, we gotta give injury updates. But before we dive into all of that, make sure you subscribe to the channel, hit the bell next to the subscription button so you get a notification immediately and every time I release an informative and opinionated video just like this one. Also, be on the lookout for all of my content. I've been working on so much draft content. I got all of my notes ready. Now I'm about to just start recording and editing those and getting them out to y'all. So be on the lookout for all of the crazy content coming out very soon. But most importantly, good dub. Let's get it. All right, so first of all, want to give some injury updates. We saw Terry McLaurin leave the game with a collarbone injury, came back, fought against that pain. Then he also fought that should have been called a helmet to helmet. I mean, that was a huge hit, and he got up and flexed his muscles for that first down and continued that drive, which eventually led to the game winning touchdown. We were already winning, but that was like the we put it away, this game is over touchdown. That again was partially led by that Terry McLaurin first down pickup. That was crazy. Oh my lord, I should have started Cam Newton in my fantasy team. I didn't, and he already has a rushing touchdown. I hate everybody. I should have started Cam Newton. That man saying I'm back, so I'm so happy. I love seeing Cam Newton be great though, but y'all already know for my biased reasons, Westlake High School, Southwest Atlanta. But back to the breaking and go. Chase Young is not looking good, bruh. I mean, it's looking like potentially a torn ACL, which is an out for season type of thing. And people aren't even thinking about the fact that not only is that possibly out for season, but he may also be hurt for quite a bit going into next season. Like, we may not see him at all in the offseason, like training camp and stuff like that. He may be hurt all the way up till November next year. So that really hurts us. Remember, Montez Sweat is already out with a broken jaw, but he's only out for like around a month, which is crazy that a month is only. But in comparison to Chase Young, that is only, because Chase Young, again, we may not see him again until next November type of thing. So that's really scary. Of course, Brandon Sheriff got hurt as well, but he ended up coming back into the game, which was good news. And then Ricky Seals-Jones got hurt as well. We don't know exactly what happened, but we saw John Bates pretty much finish out the game. He had that one fumble. We're going to talk about it later. But so we gained some injuries, but overall, I mean, we lost Chase Young. Terry McLaurin's more banged up. Brandon Sheriff a little bit banged up. And Ricky Seals-Jones, we don't know exactly what's going on, but he definitely looks hurt. So it's not looking too good, but it could have been worse. Now moving on to the position group, starting with the quarterback. Like I said in the intro, this was probably Taylor Heinicke's best game in a burgundy and gold uniform. Really his best game in his career. I mean, you could argue the Falcons game, which was crazy. The Giants game, he didn't necessarily play that well all game. He just he played really well at the end. The Falcons game, he pretty much played well all throughout and then played really well at the end. But this game, from pretty much snap one, other than some inaccuracies, which he's always going to do, not seeing a few receivers while they're wide open, which is what he's going to do. And when I say inaccuracies, I'm saying like overthrows that, you know, one of them Terry McLaurin still could have caught, but a more accurate throw would have been an easy catch for Terry McLaurin, and it ended up being incomplete. So I blame Taylor Heinicke more so for that one. But like, other than like a couple of mistakes when he normally, because he makes the same mistakes every week. You're just going to get that. It's just how often he does it. Today, he kept those mistakes to a minimum and had, you could argue, his best game as a burgundy and gold quarterback. He completed 26 of his 32 passes, which is a crazy completion percentage. I mean, he literally outplayed Tom Brady. He had one touchdown, no interceptions. I mean, this was a solid game for him. Still, at the end of the day, Taylor Heinicke to me is not a franchise quarterback, but he's a great guy to have on the roster. Because even if you say you do whatever you can to get like a Malik Willis, Matt Corral, Sam Howell, any of those guys, if they're not ready to play week one, which I'm pretty sure they won't be, like I just feel like no matter who we take in this draft, they may have to sit for a little while, unless maybe Kenny Pickett, maybe Matt Corral can start day one. But generally, it seems like no matter who we end up picking, they're more than likely going to have to sit for a little while. And Taylor Heinicke is a great bridge quarterback to have and also an excellent backup to have because, in my opinion, he's still the best backup in the NFL. But at the same time, he's just not a franchise quarterback that you try to win games with week to week because you'll get a lot of what we've seen the past few weeks versus what you'll occasionally get this week. Because I don't necessarily feel like this week was like, okay, this is what Taylor Heinicke can do. This is how he's going to play going forward forever. Like this is more him than what the last 4 weeks has been. I don't necessarily feel that way. Maybe if he puts together a good rest of the season for us and he's able to play like this consistently, then I'll change my opinion. But as of right now, I'm not necessarily saying that this game was a fluke, but again, he made the same mistakes he's always made. It's just that he made less of them today. So it's not like he necessarily fixed them. He just overall just went out there and played a better game. And I'm just not sure if I can depend on him to play how he played today consistently over not only for the course of a season, but to be a franchise quarterback. We're talking about multiple seasons ahead against better defenses that aren't as hurt, against teams that aren't as hurt, period. I mean, not to take anything from this win, but the Buccaneers are definitely the team with the most injuries we've played so far this season. But it's still a great win. I don't care. A win is a win. Even isolated, even if you take away injuries, Taylor Heinicke balled out today. Overall, the team balled out today, except for a few mistakes that were made here and there on both sides of the ball. But overall, the team played a great game. Coaching was really good. We're going to talk about that as well before we move to the defense, especially on Scott Turner's side. But again, all in all, Taylor Heinicke, good game. Great game, actually. Then moving on to the offensive line. I mean, it was weird because like they would either block well enough to spring our running backs for like a 9-yard run or more, or they would get stopped in the backfield because like no blitz pickup. Same thing with like as far as pass protection. Taylor Heinicke got sacked quite a bit, but overall they pass protected very well. But it was just the occasional plays where they sent more guys than we had offensive linemen, and like it's just nothing you could do. Like I vividly remember one play, Cornelius Lucas literally had two guys running at him. Of course, the smart thing to do is to pick up the guy coming from the inside. That's a shorter route to the quarterback. You just hope the guy going to the outside takes a little bit longer and doesn't get there in time. He got there in time, but it's just like, what can you do in that situation? So that's more so Taylor Heinicke to ID potential blitzers at the line of scrimmage. Is also on Scott Turner to design better blocking schemes to keep a running back to help if you need to, something like that. So it's between them two as far as that goes. But generally, the offensive line played really well, especially with Brandon Sheriff banged up in the game. We still don't have Samuel Cosmi. We don't have our starting almost Pro Bowl caliber center in Chase Roullier, our franchise center. So, I mean, you kind of forgot that Chase Roullier wasn't even out there in that game. Like, this is a really good game for the offensive line. They stepped up big time. They've statistically, if you look at a lot of advanced statistics like pass block win rate, run block win rate, we've had a top five offensive line so far this season. And that's even with all of the injuries we've had as well. So the offensive line has been holding it down. They've been one of our strongest position groups, arguably the strongest position group on the team. Moving on to tight end. Without Logan Thomas, our red zone efficiency has been horrible, but it got better. Better today, better play calling from Scott Turner, better execution mostly on Taylor Heinicke's part. That fade route to DeAndre Carter, you couldn't throw that better than that. And that's why our red zone efficiency was just better. And Antonio Gibson was a better running back today. And we're going to talk about him too. So it was just all execution. I mean, at the end of the day, Scott Turner, you can blame him for whatever you want to. But at the end of the day, a lot of our problems have been execution. Been Taylor Heinicke's inaccuracies and not seeing guys open. It's been Antonio Gibson fumbling. It's been guys not being able to catch the ball. Today, everything worked out. All of the stars aligned, and we went out there and played really well. So, but back to tight end. Without Logan Thomas, our red zone efficiency has been horrible. But today, everybody stepped up. Not necessarily a tight end red zone efficiency-wise, even though John Bates had a couple of catches. and Ricky Seals-Jones had a couple of important catches. They both also had bad. Ricky Seals-Jones had a bad drop. Of course, John Bates had that fumble that was terrible. But other than that, they generally all played a good game and stepped up. They still haven't been able to replace the impact of a Logan Thomas, but they played pretty decent. And for Ricky Seals-Jones and John Bates to potentially be your tight end 2 and 3 when Logan Thomas comes back healthy, that's a really good tight end group right there, in my opinion. And I just really want to get Samus Reyes going too. But I mean, we already assumed that Samus Reyes wouldn't be ready to really contribute in games at really at all this season. So I'm not surprised. I'm just really excited to see what he can do. But we may not see that this year. Who knows? Even though to me, I feel like I'm more so in the evaluation process. I want to see more Derek Forrest. I want to see some Jeremy Reeves. Even with Dax Milne, we're going to talk about him soon. I want to see more of him. I want to see all of these young guys to see what we truly have so we can know what our draft and free agency priorities should be. Because there's no reason for us to spend a high draft pick or pay a free safety a lot of money to come here if Jeremy Reeves actually can be a quality starting free safety. So I say why not and at least throw them out there to see what they can do before the end of this season. Definitely time to do some evaluating. Now the receivers, Terry McLaurin, balled out. DeAndre Carter, man, what a gem. Great returner in punts and kickoffs, and also a really good receiver that's stepping up big time with Curtis Samuel gone, because we need somebody to step up, because Terry McLaurin is the focus of defenses. So the fact that DeAndre Carter stepping up big when we need him most, he had a couple of really good catches today, most notably the best throw from Taylor Heinicke, probably you could argue all season, at least top three throws from Taylor Heinicke all season, the fade route to DeAndre Carter to the corner of the end zone. Man, shouts out to DeAndre Carter for stepping up, because man, we have really, really needed it, man. We really appreciate you. Great pickup. DeAndre Carter over Steven Sims easily right now, man. Dax Milne, I mean, he was getting open and he was making good catches. Other than that fumble, he had a really good game. He kind of basically had like an Antonio Gibson game. Like the first couple of weeks of the season, like after the Chargers game, the Giants, all of those, he would fumble. But before the fumble, he was having a good game up until the fumble. That was Dax Milne today. I mean, he was getting open. He was making catches. And then that fumble just took it all away. So like, you just can't do that. So, I mean, I still can't give you like a, if I were to do grades, I still wouldn't be able to give you a good grade. But I am excited about the future of Dax Milne because he looked good today up into that fumble. And overall, just the receiving core did what they had to do. Cam Sims caught a couple of passes that looked pretty decent. Adam Humphries, JD McKissick is always involved in the passing game. I thought he was going to be involved more than he was, but he was still fairly involved, and he did what he had to do when he had to do it. He picked up a really clutch like 3rd and 2. He got right to the first down to get it off of a short pass from Taylor Heinicke. So we really appreciate you again, JD McKissick. Even though your stats didn't really show it today, you still helped us a lot. Now going to the running backs, of course, man, Antonio Gibson balled out. You could arguably say this is one of his best games as a runner. And I mean, even regardless of the stats that he has, he didn't have a lot of yards, but he did have 2 touchdowns. Ignoring all of that, just if you're looking at like traits and what he did, like as far as vision, as far as pass protection, especially, I mean, he had some really good pass protection blocks today. And like getting more yards than you should have based on like the blocking and the defense being ready for you, breaking tackles. This was one of his best performances since we've drafted him, honestly. Again, the stats don't necessarily show it, but he came up big on that last drive. He came up big on several drives, again making guys miss, getting more yards than he should have, yards after contact. I mean, he was going stupid. The vision and again the pass protection was huge today. He had a couple of really good pass protection blocks where like if Antonio Gibson didn't make that block, Taylor Heinicke's probably getting sacked and we end up not scoring on drives that we scored. So shouts out to Antonio Gibson for that. Jared Patterson looked pretty decent running the ball, but quite a bit of the times he ran the ball, the Tampa Bay Buccaneers expected it. They blitzed and he wasn't able to do much with it. And then of course, JD McKissick wasn't involved in the game like that much. I mean, I think he caught more passes than he ran for, but you know. But shouts out to Antonio Gibson, 24 carries, 64 yards, and 2 touchdowns, no fumbles. Good game from him, man. Great game from him. Again, the stats don't tell it all, because if you go back and look at the film, Antonio Gibson had an excellent game today. And then before we go to the defense, Scott Turner, gotta congratulate you, man. That was a great play calling game today. Like I keep telling y'all, he's gonna have his ups and downs, but again, it hasn't necessarily exactly been his fault. I've been telling y'all, if we get Scott Turner a franchise quarterback, or if Taylor Heinicke can just play well, you can truly see what Scott Turner's offense is supposed to look like. And again, I'm ready to go get that franchise quarterback with a bigger arm, with more mobility and all of that type of stuff, more accuracy, better field vision than Taylor Heinicke, and then we could truly see what this Scott Turner offense is supposed to look like. We could truly unlock the potential behind it. But like I've been saying, give Scott Turner a chance, man. Once we execute, first of all, we're still not healthy. We got a little bit healthier on offense, but we're still not fully healthy. He still doesn't have his favorite target in Logan Thomas. So it's hard for him to call plays. And, you know, at the end of the day, there's no excuses. But still, like, you see what happens when the offense does what Scott Turner wants it to do. That last drive right there, that 19-play drive that literally ate up, like, the last 11 minutes of the game to literally put the game away, and then we ended it with a touchdown going for it on 4th and 1, Antonio Gibson basically untouched. I mean, that was a beautiful example of offensive play calling. That was like is pretty much as good as it gets. He was getting guys open. He ran the ball when he needed to. The pass protection was excellent. The run blocking schemes he was calling was great. I mean, Antonio Gibson was going untouched at times to a certain point. That last drive is exactly what we need from Scott Turner consistently. So we got to give congratulations to Scott Turner. I know a lot of people love to hate on him, and you can spend your time hating on him when it is his fault. But today, this win is more on him than you could probably even argue than on Taylor Heinicke. I think it's about even. They could pretty much split the congratulations, the praise. So if you hate on Scott Turner when he's bad, you got to praise him when he's good, because today was arguably his best play calling game of his career. Between this and the Giants game way back in week 2, those were his best play calling games easily. And notice how in both games, the offense just executed better. Guys were open. Taylor Heinicke was able to hit them while they were open. They were able to catch the ball when it hit their hands. You got to remember, a lot of the reason Scott Turner looks so bad is because of poor execution on the offense. So a lot of things, again, I'm not alleviating him of blame. A lot of things have been his fault, but a lot of people want to blame him for things that aren't necessarily his fault. And today he showed you the potential of his play calling. You get a Malik Willis, Matt Corral, Sam House, one of those guys in here in that offense, and watch how explosive our offense becomes. Maybe not immediately, because those guys, again, may have to sit for a while, but I'm expecting big things. And then moving to the defensive side of the ball, overall, the defense did their thing, man. Starting with the defensive line again, losing Chase Young hurt. But man, them guys stepped up. Shaka Tony stepped up and was getting pressures. Jonathan Allen still looks like literally the best defensive player on the entire team. You could probably say Cameron Curl is a close second, but that was literally Jonathan Allen right there. I mean, Jonathan Allen is balling right now. Deron Payne's doing his thing. Everybody on the defensive line generally have been doing their thing, but Jonathan Allen's been the one dominating, and Shaka Tony stepped up big with Chase Young out and Montez Sweat out. So I really appreciate them. Great game from them. I mean, they were pressuring Tom Brady all day. I mean, to stop the Buccaneers and to only allow them to score 19 points, even with the injuries they had, that's still really good defense. The defense has been picking it up the past couple of weeks. They look better. They look much better. And Landon Collins, I never really heard his name called, which is a good thing. That means he didn't give up big plays in coverage. But we're going to talk about that soon. Linebackers, Jamin Davis made a couple of plays. Cole Holcomb did his thing. Again, when you don't hear their names, that's normally a good thing. Because Jamin Davis was second on our team and tackles was 6th. The only person that had more tackles than him was Cameron Curl, who balled out. We're going to talk about him. Other than getting ran over, Cameron Curl was like right there behind Jonathan Allen. And then Cole Holcomb was 4th in tackles with 5. So, I mean, overall, David Mayo, 3 tackles. Landon Collins, who's technically a linebacker now, had 3. Overall, just a decent game from the linebackers. Not bad, not great. Like, you saw the Buccaneers linebackers out there making plays. Our linebackers didn't necessarily make plays, but they just played well enough for the defense to hold it down, which is kind of what I expected. Going into this season from the offseason, I expected our defensive line to be more dominant than it's been. I expected our linebackers to have more games like this where they don't necessarily help us win, but they also don't help us lose as well, somewhere in the middle. And then I expected our secondary to be a little bit better than it's been. But today, the linebackers did their thing. Again, nothing exceptional, but also nothing to make us lose the game. I appreciate it. Then the secondary, without Benjamin St. Juice, held it down. I mean, the William Jackson interception, that was a play by Cameron Curl. Shouts out to Cameron Curl for that. Again, Cameron Curl led our team in tackles with 8. He was everywhere. Passes, defense, everything. Other than the time he got ran over by Leonard Fournette, this was a great game from him. Jonathan Allen and Cameron Curl are easily our defensive MVPs today. for sure. Again, William Jackson, that interception was an opportunistic one. And, like, I don't want to give him too much credit for it, but you can see by the fact that Kendall Fuller didn't catch that interception later on in the game that we do need to give William Jackson some credit, because Kendall Fuller can't catch an interception and save his life, man. But that was really camera curl more than anything else. But other than that interception that William Jackson had, decent coverage up and down the game. He had a couple of plays where he got beat, but overall it was decent coverage. Kendall Fuller, same thing. Decent coverage pretty much the majority of the game. But he did get killed by Mike Evans at the end. But you saw him and Ron Rivera go to the refs at the end of the game. I'm about to look at the film, because they were basically complaining about how Mike Evans really just had an offensive pass interference and y'all didn't call it. So I'm about to go back and look to see if Kendall Fuller got killed for real or not, or if that was really pass interference by Mike Evans and it just wasn't called. But either way, the secondary had a pretty decent day. I mean, Bobby McCain didn't hear his name called much. That's a good thing. As long as Bobby McCain's name isn't being said a lot, that's a good thing. That means he's out there just in coverage and holding it down. We appreciate it. And I appreciate him for catching that one interception as well. So definitely one of the best games our secondary has had all season. Again, they all made a couple of mistakes here and there, but overall they held it down. And it's a lot of it is thanks to the fact that the defensive line was getting a lot of pressure on Brady, so that made their jobs easier. Can't wait for Benjamin St. Juice to come back, because then our secondary is only going to get better. Our defense is starting to shape up how I kind of expected it to be before the season started. Sadly, we don't have Montez Sweat till like December. We don't have Chase Young until like November 2022 possibly, but overall our defense is starting to shape up, and you can see if we're fully healthy why this defense should be dominant again. It just took them a while to get it together the first few weeks. I don't know what that was, but now Jack Del Rio and his guys are starting to really put it together. And now, I mean, you could honestly say this was the first game all season that our offense and our defense was good. This is one of the only games our offense and our defense both played well at the same time since Rivera has been our head coach. And you can even go further back than that with Jay Gruden, further back than that. I mean, we finally had a game where all phases of the ball played well. Normally it's our defense and then our offense is bad. This season it started being our offense was playing well and then our defense was bad. And then the past couple of weeks our offense was bad and then our defense started to get it together. Today everybody played well in all phases of the game, so that was great. And speaking of all phases of the game, special teams, I mean, they played well. DeAndre Carter had a couple of good returns, but nothing major. No muff punts, that's huge. Tressway is always going to do his thing. The only punt that he had that wasn't like exceptional was when we were backed up on our own 1 yard line. He was in the back of the end zone. He had to hurry up and kick it before it got blocked. So and he only kicked it to like the 50 yard line, which is again underperforming for Tressway standards. But and speaking of special teams, have we found our franchise kicker, bro? Let me know now. Have we found our franchise kicker, bro? Joey Sly, 3 of 3 for field goals, 2 of 2 for extra points. Is it time for me to even pick him up in fantasy? I mean, 100% across the board, he contributed 11 points by himself this game, man. I really appreciate you, because I was scared too. I was like, bro, we're not going to beat the Buccaneers only with field goals. And he made every field goal we needed him to, and then we finally started scoring touchdowns, so that's why we won the game. But man, have we finally found our franchise kicker? Our third starting kicker in 4 games, and we finally figured it out. Is Ron Rivera looking like a genius now? Man, because I mean, he kicked a 46 yarder like it was nothing. I mean, he made that look easy. Because the thing with Chris Blewett, he made long kicks 45 and up, like 50 yarders, look easy. But the shorter ones, he was kicking into the back of offensive linemen. Dustin Hopkins would usually make the shorter kicks, but if it was 45 yards or longer, it was, I doubt he's gonna make this. We might as well go for it on fourth down or just punt it so we don't give up good field positioning. But Joey Sly made the short ones, the 20 yarders, the extra points, and he made the 46 yarder look easy. I mean, he made the 46 yarder look like he could have made a 50 something if it had to be that. You know what I'm saying? So, man, Joey Sly, definitely really impressed with you. You're definitely one of the MVPs of the game. Again, I would say Antonio Gibson, this offensive line, Terry McLaurin, Taylor Heinicke, Joey Sly, Scott Turner, Jonathan Allen, Cameron Curl are like, I would say the top 8. I hope I didn't miscount. I hope I didn't say somebody's name twice. Top 8, top 7. Those are like the top guys. And then everybody else around them stepped up and played well as well. But those are definitely your top guys. Those are your MVPs, whatever you want to call them, man. They all of those guys did their thing. Again, Scott Turner, shouts out to you. And I mean, again, we got to give credit to Jack Del Rio, because his defense is finally starting to play well. Maybe a little too late, but hopefully we can carry that into next season, man, because they seem like they finally figured something out. But yeah, man, that's the end of this video. Shouts out to the Burgundy and Gold winning 20-19. That was a great win again. Definitely one of the best wins under Ron Rivera that we've had since he's been our head coach for almost 2 years now. Man, that was a really fun dub. I really appreciate everybody for going out there for balling and balling out. I feel like this is just one of those dubs that it's just like we have to remember this game and to remember to play like this. So no matter how the rest of the season goes, if we don't win another game, we got to remember that we can play up to this potential. There's a lot of injuries, so I'm not expecting a lot of greatness for the rest of the season. But when even just some of our guys are healthy, look how well we can play as a team. Look how good our special teams can be. Look how good our defense can be. Look how good our offense can be. How efficient our offense can be. So this is one of those games that has me really optimistic about the future. Not necessarily the rest of this season, but like as far as 2022 goes, if we fix a lot of the holes we have, I mean, most notably, again, I don't want to take anything away from Taylor Heinicke, but like, again, I think Taylor Heinicke may end up starting week one next year, even if we do draft a quarterback. But if you can get a guy with a more explosive arm, same amount of mobility or more than Taylor Heinicke, more accuracy, the sky's the limit for this offense for sure. And especially with DeAndre Carter stepping up now and Antonio Gibson starting to figure it out now that he's finally back, you know, as healthy as he's probably gonna get. But yeah, man, that's the end of this video. Please get in the comment section, let me know how you feel about everything discussed in this video. Please like it if you learned anything, if you like the video. Also, definitely, I mean, of course, get in the comment section and let me know how you felt about the game, your positives, your negatives, who you liked, who you didn't like, all of that. Break it all down, man. I'm gonna definitely be in the comment section reading everything. Even if I don't get a chance to reply, I try to make sure I read as much as possible. Also, appreciate all of the support, man. Shouts out to everybody that donated in the stream, and I really appreciate y'all. A special shout out to all of my sponsors, especially my Pro Bowl sponsors, whose name you see scrolling on the screen right now. I'm gonna catch y'all with the post game live stream around 6 something, so make sure y'all pull up for that. I'll catch y'all later. I'm out.